How's it going, everyone? It's me, Lone, and we have finally moved into our brand new apartment. That was an absolute week from hell. Everything that could have gone wrong did go wrong. We had a delay in our bank settlement, so I was stressing over that. We had money to pay that we didn't think that we had to, and we're just out of pocket for that now. And then, of course, there was the move itself, which has just wrecked me, including my back, so I'm still recovering a little bit. So I am sorry that there's been such a delay in uploading my video or my next video, but I'm just glad to be done. And I'm also glad because we are now in my new studio. This is going to be my brand new office for making YouTube videos moving forward. So let me know what you think of the setup. It took ages to get right, but I think it turned out okay. And one last thing, thank you to everyone for helping me reach 85,000 subscribers on the YouTube channel. Every time we reach a milestone like this, I don't believe it, because just earlier this year, my channel was genuinely in the toilet, and now we're actually on track to reaching 100,000 subscribers, which has been a goal of mine for so long. So thank you to all of you that have subscribed, and to those of you that have followed me for a while, I really do appreciate your support. But with all that out of the way, let's get to the topic of this video. So because I haven't been playing 76 for about a week because of the move, I have a lot of catching up to do. I have a lot of catching up in terms of ranking up my legendary perk cards, and especially in terms of the season two armor race scoreboard. I need to move up as much as I can to ensure that I finish it on time. And because of all that, I want to do some power leveling in the game. Power leveling is a great way to rank up your legendary perk cards and also to move up on the season two scoreboard. So I want to create a guide and an updated video on how best to power level in Fallout 76. I have created one in the past, but it was like 30 plus minutes long. It was too detailed, too convoluted, too in-depth. This is going to be way more succinct and to the point. This is exactly everything that you need to know for how to power level in Fallout 76 in 2020. So let's do it. Alrighty, so we're here in the game. I've got my notes next to me so I don't miss out on anything. And here is my updated guide for how to power level in Fallout 76 for 2020. So when it comes to leveling up very fast in the game, intelligence is key. The more intelligence that your character has, the more XP that you're going to get. Whether it's in terms of killing enemies, which is going to be the main way of gaining XP, crafting, etc. Having more intelligence is always going to help you gain a lot more XP. The next most important special stat is probably charisma, because the more charisma that your character has, the more XP that you're going to get for doing public events, but that only really applies when you turn in those public events. So if you can only focus on one, intelligence is definitely more important. But of course, if you really want to maximize your XP and you could spare the points, increase both of them. So it's totally up to you. But let's go to the perk point or perk card menu to talk about intelligence a little bit more. So very roughly, for every additional point of intelligence that your character has, you get plus 2 percentage points more of XP. So ideally what you want to do, if you really want to focus on gaining a lot of XP, is increase your intelligence to 15 here. You don't need to, because there are other ways of increasing your intelligence, and I'll talk about those later on in the video. But if you really want to focus on it, get it to 15 here. There are different ways of going about this. Of course, you can simply just level up and shift your perk points around to get this to 15, or you can actually utilize legendary special perk cards. So for instance, you could have your intelligence at say 10, and then you can equip the legendary intelligence perk card and max it out, which is going to give you an additional 5 to your intelligence, therefore taking you to 15. If you go down this route, make sure you don't have your intelligence above 10, because perk points actually cap at 15, and you're not going to be able to equip as many perk cards on your character as you otherwise would. So make sure that you don't do that. Equally, you can actually utilize any of these other legendary special perk cards. It doesn't necessarily matter, because all they're doing is giving you more perk points to work with, right? So at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what combination that you want to employ. Do what you want, but just make sure that at the end of it, your intelligence is at 15, because that's going to be key. But yes, there are other ways to increase your intelligence, so let's talk about that. So mutations. Mutations are a great way to increase your special stats and, of course, your intelligence. Let's talk about the ones that specifically will help you increase your intelligence. First up, let's talk about herd mentality. So herd mentality is a mutation that gives you +2 to all of your special stats, including intelligence, when you're in a team. The obvious downside to that is that you kind of always need to be in a team, but because we have public teams now, whether you're in a private or a public server, you can simply, you know, create a public team or join a public team, and herd mentality is going to be active. So you can still technically play solo if you want, and herd mentality is still going to be there. You just can't play solo with like Lone Wanderer and actually not being in a team, you know, so just keep that in mind. But herd mentality is great because it's going to give you as a base an additional 2 to your intelligence. The next most important one, actually probably the most important one, is Egghead. So Egghead is going to give you 6 as a base to your intelligence, which is a huge boost to your intelligence. The downside is that it decreases your strength and endurance by 3 each, but you can counteract that and you can actually make the positive effect of that mutation even better. So let's talk about how you do that. I'm going to go to my perk card menu again. So let's talk about Stranger Numbers first. So I actually don't have it equipped because everyone shares it nowadays. But Stranger Numbers is a great perk card because what it does is it increases the positive effects of your mutations by 25%, right? So all of those boosts to intelligence that I talked about before are just getting 25% stronger. That's why when you look at my mutations, that's why Egghead is giving me 8 instead of 6. That's why Herd Mentality is giving me 3 instead of 2. So Stranger Numbers is a great perk card because it's only a single perk point as well. It's a great and easy perk card to equip and also to share, which is why everyone shares it nowadays. So yes, one way or another, make sure that you have Stranger Numbers equipped. Also though, what you want to make sure is to have Class Freak as well and have it maxed out, because what that's going to do is decrease the negative effects of your mutations by 75%. So not only does that make mutations such as Egghead more viable, because now my strength is only being decreased by 1 and my endurance is only being decreased by 1, but what it's also doing as well is it's actually counteracting when it comes to mutations like Marsupial, because Marsupial, which is probably one that you have, everyone has it nowadays because it's so fun to use, Marsupial decreases your intelligence by 4 as a base. So when you have Class Freak active, it only decreases it, and where is it, by 1. So as you can see there, if you can read the text, Marsupial is decreasing my intelligence by 1. If I unequip Class Freak, it's now being decreased by 4. Which is obviously not good for me getting XP. So that's why Class Freak is another great perk card that you want to have equipped. So make sure to have both of them, again, if you really want to focus on XP. So we talked about the mutations, we talked about Class Freak and Stranger Numbers. Again, if you want to increase your charisma a little bit, do that if you can spare the points. But for me, it's not as important, right? So let's move on to talking about unyielding armor and having an unyielding build in general, or a bloodied build, if you will. So, as you can see, my health is below 20%. I rock what is called an unyielding or a bloodied build. Essentially, my health is always below 20%, and then I have a full set of unyielding armor. So one here, one there, one there, one there, one there. What these pieces of armor do is that they each give you up to 3 to all of your special stats excluding endurance. So that obviously includes intelligence. So therefore, when your health is below 20%, you get 15 more to all of your special stats excluding endurance. That's why when you look at my special and my intelligence, it's actually really high, much higher than it is in this menu here, because namely, like, those unyielding pieces of armor are really helping me boost it. But of course, the mutations and other things are all also affecting it too. So if you really want to focus on gaining a lot of intelligence, you probably want to use an unyielding or a bloodied build. But you don't have to, because it is a specific build, albeit it's a very popular build, but it is still a specific build, and I don't want you going about changing your builds completely if you're happy with them just to have more intelligence. There are other ways to boost it, but again, this is probably one of the best ways to do so, so I'm just letting you know I kind of have to as part of the guide. So let's talk about public teams now. Public teams is another great way to increase your intelligence. And specifically, the name has changed now. The public team that you want to create is the one called casual, because this is going to give you more intelligence. When you create a casual team, as a default, you get 1 more to intelligence. But as more people join, and as they become fully bonded, and as you can see, my team now is fully bonded and I have a full team with me, you get even more intelligence when you do that, right? But then there are also There are also other public teams that help you with XP. So the hunting one helps you get more XP for killing legendary enemies. Roleplay helps you get more charisma, which again helps you with getting more XP for doing public events. There is the events one, which gets you specifically more XP for doing public events. The daily ops one gives you more XP for doing daily ops. But what you can actually do is if you're the host of or the leader of a team, you can have your team as casual and then change to any of the other public teams when the need arises. So for instance, let's say you're doing a daily op and you're about to complete it. What you can do is keep the casual public team until you're about to finish it and then quickly swap to the daily ops public team, get the increased XP from completing that daily op, and then you change back. So how do you actually do that? Well, if you go to this menu here, click on your username, you can simply change the public team goal if you're the leader. So let's talk about the events one. If I'm about to complete an event, I change to that, and it's very easy. All I do is that it's now an events team. If I look at my special, my intelligence was just decreased by 4 because having a fully bonded intelligence team or a casual team is increasing my intelligence by 4. But now I get more XP for completing a public event. Now that I've, you know, let's say I've just completed the event and I got all the XP that I wanted, then I can change it back to casual. And all that's gonna do is increase my intelligence by 4 again. So that's a cheeky little way to be able to maximize your XP completely in the game, no matter what you're doing. It's a great way to do it. So we've talked about public teams. Let's talk about some other things. Back to perk cards. The perk card here that's probably the most important in terms of gaining XP is probably inspirational. Again, it's a perk card that requires you to be in a team, but when you have it maxed out and you are in a team, you get 15% more XP. It's a huge boost, and it's a constant boost for you, and it's only 3 perk points. So if you really want to focus on XP, make sure to have inspirational active. I never unequip it anymore nowadays because XP is so important. So keep that in mind. And then let's talk about the well-rested bonus. So I'm actually going to go steal Ward's old bed. I don't see him here anymore because he's in his little office. But I'm just going to sleep right now, right? It doesn't matter which bed that you sleep in because no matter where you sleep in, if you're there for long enough, it's going to activate the well-rested bonus. And what the well-rested bonus is going to do is give you an additional 5% more XP for whatever you do in the game for about 2 hours, right? If you have an ally and you're sleeping in your camp, it turns into something different. It's called Lover's Embrace or Kindred Spirit, I believe it is. And it's still 5% boost, but it's just increasing the length of time that it applies. But because you go back to your camp so often and it's very easy to sleep, you probably don't need to do that all the time, but just keep in mind it's called something different if you have an ally. But this is about to activate. It doesn't take too long, so I'll get out now. It says I feel well rested. Then I can go into my effects menu in my Pip Boy, and then it's going to say I am gaining 5% more XP in the game, which is great. I am well rested for 2 hours. So make sure that you do that as well. There's a process here. When you join a new server, you create a casual public team or you join one. You sleep in your bed to get that boost to XP. You make sure all those perk cards are equipped. There's a process here that you need to go down the list every time you join a game to make sure you're fully maximizing your XP. And yes, well rested is an important way to do that. So let's go down to events. This is one that's not so reliable because it only pops up every now and again, but there is an event. Oh my God, it is actually on. What are the chances when I'm recording this video? This event is really great. It's called Path to Enlightenment, right? And by the end of it, you'll spawn the Wise Mothman and you'll touch him essentially, and you'll get an additional 5% more XP in the game. And you know what? Let's do it. I'm going to jump to this event and we're going to get that extra XP. Alrighty, so we've completed Path to Enlightenment. Here is the Wise Mothman. I'm going to now commune with the Mothman. And now I feel enlightened in his presence. And then, oh my God, get away, rad toads, you annoying creatures. And then I'm going to go to my effects. And now I have the Wisdom of the Mothman and I get an additional 5% more experience in the game. It was so coincidental that this event was on in the middle of my recording because that rarely happens. So when this event does pop up on your map, make sure to do it, you know, commune with the Mothman, and then you get that additional 5% more experience. Let's go back to Foundation and we'll complete the rest of the video. So we're now back at Foundation, and let's talk about consumable items in the game. So consumables are also a great way to increase your XP in Fallout 76, whether that's in terms of bobbleheads, chems, magazines, food items, etc., drinks even. There are a lot of consumables out there that can help you increase your charisma, your intelligence, and straight out your XP to help you, of course, get more XP in the game. But there are some things that you need to keep in mind when it comes to consumables in the game, mainly being the way that they stack. So very generally, and there are much more nuances and details to this that I'm not going to go into now, but very generally, you can't take the same type of consumable in the game that are each boosting the exact same stat and expect that they're going to stack together. So for instance, you can't take a food item that increases your XP and another or the same food item that also increases your XP, because the last one that you take is just going to replace the previous effect. They're not going to stack together when you use them like that. So let's say it's a cranberry cobbler and a cranberry relish, which both increase your XP, right? You can't stack them together when you use them at the same time, and you're just wasting your consumables. But what you can stack together are different types of consumables. So you can actually stack a bobblehead, a food item, a chem, etc., magazine, a drink item, altogether, even if they're boosting the exact same stat like XP, because they are different types of consumables, they will all be active and apply at the same time. So very generally, that is the rule, so keep that in mind. Also as well, consumables are, of course, temporary effects. They can be 2 minutes, an hour, etc. So keep that in mind. When you use it, they're going to run out eventually. So what you want to do is try and hoard as many of them as possible so you can use them when you're about to get a lot of XP, like for instance, when you're about to kill a bunch of enemies. That's what you want to do. Also though, keep in mind that food items eventually spoil, so don't collect too many of them because you're just going to end up with a bunch of spoiled meat or spoiled vegetables or fruit. So, and then let's talk about mutations again, because there are certain mutations that can actually help you double the benefit of food items, namely being vegetable products and also, there's a nuke, and also meat products. So if you have the herbivore mutation, which is what I have now, and you eat a vegetable product that boosts your XP, having the herbivore mutation actually doubles the boost of XP that you would normally get if you didn't have the mutation, for instance. Equally, if you had the carnivore mutation and you ate a meat product that increased your XP, like canned meat stew, you're again going to get double the boost to your XP than you would otherwise get if you didn't have that mutation. So those mutations are a great way to be able to get even more XP in the game. But keep in mind, if you're a herbivore, you're not going to get any boosts from eating meat products. And equally, if you're a carnivore, you're not going to get any boost from eating vegetable products. So you're going to have to specialize, but pick one of them, right? Pick one of them, pick the one that's easy for you to get food items for, and then get that double benefit. Also as well, because there are mutations in effect here, they're actually going to be boosted thanks to Stranger Numbers. So I want to give you a bit of a demonstration right now. So I'm actually going to leave this team just to prove a point, and then we'll join in again. So I have a cranberry cobbler here. So this is, it tells me it's increasing my XP by 10%. As a base value, cranberry cobbler actually only increases XP by 5, but because I have that herbivore mutation, it's now 10. But because herbivore is a mutation, right? Stranger Numbers can actually boost that effect, that doubling effect, by another 25%. So let me join a team again. So I'm in a team with a mutated person. And now, if I look at the cranberry cobbler, the boost in my XP, it says it's 13. I think it's technically 12.5 and it's rounding up, but it's even more now. It's 25% stronger. So again, there's even more reason for you to have one of those mutations and to have Stranger Numbers in effect. So you get even more XP, more intelligence, more charisma when you're consuming these consumable items in the game, specifically meat products and vegetable products. So now let's talk about the actual consumables. What are they? They're all mentioned in the description below, so you know what they are exactly. But I'm going to go through them now so you can hear me babble a little bit more. In terms of the consumables that boost your XP, I hope I have all of them here. You have lunchboxes, which increase your XP by 25%, and of course they can stack together up to 100%, and when you use them, you can actually share them with people around you. So what I suggest to do with lunchboxes, if you're in an event, if you're doing a nuke, whatever it is, and you're around people, you use this little lunchbox emoji, and then hopefully that'll prompt people to also open their lunchboxes, and then you can stack them to 100%. But if you have four, you can just use them all on yourself if you really want to. The beauty about lunchboxes now as well is that you can buy them from Samuel in Foundation. You can actually trade for 100 gold bullion, 3 lunchboxes, right? And I want to do that now because I want more lunchboxes. And then you can actually exit out and then buy even more from him. So it's actually 100 per lunchbox. So it's 300 in total if you buy all 3, gold bullion specifically. But yeah, they're so easy to get now, especially if you've already bought all the items that you want with gold bullion. So make sure that you're doing this as often as you can. But then let's talk about the other consumables that help you with XP. So there's the leader bobblehead, which gives you 5% more XP, Cranberry Relish, which is 10% more XP, Living Live number 8 magazine gives you 5% more XP when you're in a team, Cranberry Cobbler, as I said, 5% more XP, Cam Eat Stew is 5%, Tasty Squirrel Stew is 10%, and Cranberry Juice, which is a drink, is 2% more XP. So what I suggest you do, as you can see, by the way, I have the Leader Bobblehead, which is giving me that XP, I have the Cranberry Cobbler, I have the Lunchbox, etc. What I suggest you do is obviously try and buy and find as many of those bobbleheads and magazines as you can, because they're not so easy to find sometimes. And when it comes to the food items, pick one that's very easy for you to make. That's not going to require you to do a lot of searching, unless you want to, and a lot of crafting. The one that I do, again, is Cranberry Cobbler, because all it requires is fresh cranberries and wood. And then you can simply create one, and I get more XP. And the place that I get my cranberries from is from Sunrise Field. There's a Milo Queen that you need to kill, but it's very easy to get. Equally, if you are a carnivore, Cam Eat Stew you get from one of those events. I can't remember what it's called, but you get Cam Eat Stew from an event. All I'm saying is just pick the one that's easy for you to get and then leverage that as much as you can. Even though I could be getting more XP with Cranberry Relish, it's a little bit harder to make, so I just don't bother with it, right? Let's talk about intelligence boost now. So in terms of intelligence, you have the intelligence bobblehead, which gives you 2 more intelligence, brain bombs, which is 3, broiled scorch beast brain, which is 3, owlet nuggets, 2, scorch beast mixed meat stew, 2, brain fungus soup, 2, steeped aster tea or steeped tato flower tea, which is 2, berry mentats, which is 5, daddy-o, 3, mentats, 2, and XL, 2, but only for 2 minutes. So those are the intelligence boosts specifically. And then there are the charisma boosts, which is corn pone, which is 2, mothman egg omelette, which is 2, sweet roll, 3, alcohol generally is 1 more to charisma, mountain honey is 1, XL again is 2, because that boosts all your specials. Day Tripper is 3, and Great Mentats is 5. Again, they're all in the description below, along with the actual boosts themselves. So make sure that you're utilizing consumables in Fallout 76. Finally, let's talk about where you go and what you do to get a lot of XP. So you've gone down that list that I've mentioned, and you're maxing out your XP as much as possible. Where do you go and what you do? Number one, kill enemies. That is going to be the way that you get lots of XP in the game. So essentially, you want to go to areas of the map that there are a lot of enemies, and especially a lot of enemies at a higher level. And that's way easier nowadays, thanks to One Wasteland, because enemies are scaling to you. So I'm very easily finding enemies at a 60, 100 even, pretty much wherever I go in the game. There are exceptions to that, of course, and that's just how One Wasteland works. But it just makes it way easier. And then, of course, to encourage you to get more or to find more of those enemies, go to events like Radiation Rumble, Line in the Sand, any event that you can remember where a lot of enemies spawn, and again, they're going to be higher level now thanks to One Wasteland, go to those events and kill those enemies. Or, if there are no events that are actually applicable or active on the map, you can go to areas that I told you in my previous legendary video, like West Tech, and I'll actually show you them. I'm gonna show you where I go in the game so you know exactly where to go. West Tech, great area because there's a lot of high level super mutants there. Then I'll probably go to Huntersville next because there's even more super mutants there. Then I'll probably go to White Springs because there's ghouls there that you can find. Then I'll see Swarm of Suitors is an event that you can do if you wanted to. Where else do I go? I go to the abandoned Bogtown camp here or the actual area here because there's even more super mutants there. Where else? General Steakhouse, great place to find super mutants. Robco, there's a bunch of robots there. You notice that there's a trend. I usually go here because there's a lot of especially high level enemies there. But yes, there are some places, just some places that are going to give you a good amount of XP. And I'm sure people in the comments below are going to have some more suggestions. But that's it. I don't want to take too much more of your time. That is as quick as I could do it. That is my guide to how to power level in Fallout 76 for 2020. Let's get to the conclusion of this video. Alrighty, Waysenders, we are all done. Thank you so much for watching this video. I really appreciate it. Let me know if there's anything that I can clarify in the comments below. And until next time, this has been the Lone Vault Wanderer. Please take care of yourselves, and would you kindly keep fighting the good fight.